Good morning. My name is Massimo Antonelli. I am a head of the Department of Intensive Care Anesthesiology at the Catholic University in Rome, Italy. My task today is just to speak about the subglottic colonization as a prediction measure for the onset of ventilator-associated pneumonia. And I will allude also to the some implication concerning COVID-19 patients. These are my conflict of interests. It is worthwhile to look at some data coming from a recent update published in Critical Care by the group of Ignacio Martin Loches regarding the treatment of nosocomial pneumonia into the ICU. Also because in this case are summarized in various environments, such as the world of the ICU, the progression of the disease that may regard various conditions, including pneumonia occurring when the patients are not intubated, or patients who, in consequence of the colonization of oropharyngeal colonization, sedation, the chest physiotherapy, very limited for limited resources or delirium, may imply the onset of this disease. Another important aspect that pertains colonization and consequent the onset of an infectious disease of the respiratory tract concerns the microbiome. And various studies have shown how the change of the microbiome into the patients who are admitted to the ICU may represent an open door for the development of ventilator-associated pneumonia sustained by pathological germs such as Pseudomonas aeruginosa. And specifically, in these cases, it's evident from this figure how different may be between those patients who had no ICU hospital acquired pneumonia and those who had an ICU hospital acquired pneumonia, where the kind of microbiome is substantially different. The problem is related to the fact that oropharyngeal secretion may accumulate over the cuff of the endotracheal tube, and some particles of these secretions may be inadvertently inhaled through the small microscopic channel of the cuff, being inhaled, colonizing also the distal airways and causing the infections. The use of tubes with intermittent subglottic secretion drainage has been shown to be a potential device for reduce the onset of ventilator-associated pneumonia. In this study published years ago in the Blue Journal, the primary endpoint was to assess the incidence of VAP in the patient who received the subglottic drainage. And the secondary endpoint were the rate of early and late onset of VAP. A considerable number of patients enrolled per group, 164. And interestingly, a clear-cut benefit in terms of adoption of this kind of tubes in terms of probability of remaining free of ventilator-associated pneumonia over time, between control group and patient receiving this kind of tubes. Well, I think it is very important also consider the kind of diagnosis that we can apply and adopt for making the identification of hospital-acquired pneumonia. And if you look in this study to 200 patients who receive various forms of microbiological sampling, you may see that 34% of them received sputum, endotracheal aspiration in reasons of between 32 and 43%. for when the sampling was done and positive, fiber optic bronchoscopy or bronchoalveolar lavage. All these things and all these procedures are open procedures with an intrinsic risk of aerosolization. You may imagine how important may be once again when the tumulon gas clouds of respiratory pathogens may diffuse into the environment by using open techniques, how dangerous may be, especially when patients with COVID-19 are interested. We propose a methodology different by using the subglottic secretions just to culture and compare if they had the possibility to predict the isolates of the endotracheal aspirate in bronchoalveolar lavage. If this is true, as I will show you in the next few slides, this could be a good suggestion for using these kind of tubes and diagnostic in patients with COVID-19. In total, we enrolled 109 patients, and we verified 45 episodes of clinically suspected VAP. If you look at the subglottic secretion in comparison to endotracheal aspirate, you can immediately realize that the negative predicted value of subglottic aspiration and the positive predicted value, even though not perfect, are indeed 82% and 77% respectively, then having the possibility of having consistencies of the pathogen isolated in both samples in 88% of the cases. And the kind of the germs that were isolated were the most classical MDR germs into the ICU, Acinetobacter, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Staph aureus, Klebsiella, and Enterobacter species. When the subglottic secretion cultures were compared to the bronchoalveolar lavage, the negative predicted value and positive predicted value, despite a consistency in terms of identical germs isolated, were not were suboptimal, 65% in both cases. But when you measure and you compare the endotracheal culture versus the bronchoalveolar lavage cultures, the negative predicted values and the positive predicted values were indeed not so higher in comparison to those obtained by subglottic secretions. Which are my conclusions? That subglottic secretions cultures show a quite worthy accuracy in identifying endotracheal aspirate isolate with a good coincidence. The sensitivity and was quite good, with a good negative predicted value. And after all, this may be not inferior to endotracheal aspirate in predicting the results of BAL in case of VAP. So, in case of the patients in presence of SARS-CoV-2, the avoidance of any open techniques for the diagnosis of HAP, VAP, and VAT may be an option, and probably this can be kept in mind treating our patients. Thank you.